to the agenda. Item one is members' code of conduct, declarations of interest. If any cabinet members wish to declare any interest. Bernie?
Interest is it number eight? Because of my, because I sit on the visa committee board, so. Also 15, number 15.
15,
sorry.
Item 15. 15.
Sorry.
Okay. Next, Stuart? So you're going to leave the room?
Yes,
I will declare an interest in item 8, the capital monitoring report, because it's a reference to the hive, which is the Wirral Youth Zone. I'm on the board of the Wirral Youth Zone, so I'll declare a personal interest in that item. Any more for anyone? Right, so let's go on to the minutes from the last meeting. Can we agree that I am consigned as a true record?
Yes.
Thank you. Okay, item three is the executive key decisions taken under delegated powers. We're just noting those decisions. Item four is the Liverpool City Region Combined Authority. So this is the minute 71 from the council meeting on 14th of November. And we're being asked to effectively, this is an executive side decision, so it's being asked to confirm that minute.
Confirm that minute and also agree with the to the LCL order, which is the
okay, so I'll move. We agree those items. Is that great? Okay. And we agree the recommendations in the report at page 1, going over to page 2. Are those? Yeah, I'm making it clear that we also agree the revised order, which we've got in front of us as well. Yeah. So, is that great? So we'll go on now to item 5, which is delivering Wirral's growth. So I'll briefly introduce this. So this is a report which is asking officers to work up a business case and business plan for establishing a regeneration company effectively to move forward with our plans around regeneration opportunities in Birkenhead and elsewhere. The report makes clear that in many authorities elsewhere there is a good argument for saying that these projects should be done through an arm's length company that can act in a commercial way, can use the council's sort of assets to generate returns and maybe set up joint venture companies, etc. So there's some interesting models of good practice around these regeneration companies in authorities in areas like Birmingham and Manchester. So all this report is doing is asking officers to come back with a business case on how we might do this to set up this arm's length company. Also authorising officers to assemble a small project team to progress this work. I'm just going to make a slight change to the recommendation 1, which talks about coming back to January 2017. I think we need to give the officers slightly more time than that to work these proposals up. So I'm suggesting that they come back to our meeting in February with convinced that this is a useful way forward, but let's have a look at the business case first and see how that stacks up before we, you know, commit to anything definitively. So that's all this report is asking for authority to do. Is that great?
Thank you. Thank you
very much. Okay, item six is the statement of accounts and annual audit letter 2015-16. I think these have been to the Audit and Risk Management Committee, so it's coming to us for noting. I mean, I was pleased to see in carrier 3.6 that the outturn for 15-16 showed an underspending revenue budget of 1.3 million. I think that was a good outcome, and I want to thank the officers involved across the council for that outturn. I think it's really good. It's becoming more difficult to balance the budget, as we'll talk about in a later item. But really asking Cabinet to note the statement of accounts 15-16, the audit letter, and secondly, the progress on delivering the actions identified in the annual governance statement to be monitored as is usual by the Audit and Risk Management Committee. So I'll move those recommendations. Do they agree? Okay, thank you. Okay, item seven is the revenue monitoring report for 2016-17, quarter two. Again, it's pleasing to see the overall position at quarter two is forecast underspending 0.2 million, 200,000 for 16-17, which is an improvement on quarter one. Obviously, I want to highlight in the table on page 33 some ongoing challenges really around particularly social care. We can see that the adult social care and children and people's budget is under severe pressure. We all know about the pressures on our social care budget. Demand is sadly increasing, partly because of the pressure that many families in the borough are under. Clearly, you know, the government's austerity policies of tightening sort of benefits, etc., is not helping. But I particularly want to highlight what I think is a crisis in social care. I mean, I saw some figures the other day from the LGA that said that by 2019-20, I think it is, we're looking at a shortfall in the social care funding across the country, across England, of 1.3 billion, which is clearly a huge sort of problem for local authorities across the country. And you know, you can see from the pressures on our own budget here how that's hitting home locally. And you know, I do believe it was a missed opportunity for the Chancellor not to mention anything about social care in his autumn statement. I think there was an opportunity there. I think many people in local were expecting the government would at least announce some help for councils with social care budgets, but sadly there was nothing. So I want to add, if I can ask the Cabinet to look at recommendations on page 30, in addition to those four recommendations, I'd like to move the following additional recommendation, and I'll just briefly move this out. Cabinet believes that the failure by the Chancellor of the Exchequer to announce any additional funding to tackle the crisis in social care in his recent autumn statement was a huge missed opportunity. And Cabinet requests that all parties on the Council make strong representations to the Government to make extra resources available for social care as a matter of urgency to ensure that authorities like Wirral can continue to provide good quality care to the most vulnerable members of our community. And this is where the social care shortfall is really hitting home, the most vulnerable people in our communities. So in addition to the four recommendations, I'm going to suggest that we agree that additional recommendation. Happy to take any comments on the report generally. Anne?
Yeah, Chair, I think it's really important to point out here that the government are telling us that we're allowed through the social care precept. Whenever this issue is raised, the government social care. But look in this report, halfway through the year, we're £3.5 million adrift here, and we only get £2 million in through the precept. So already we're running to try and catch up. The government's taking no consideration of changed demographics, of people living longer. It's as though this is a forgotten, you know, band of the community that just don't exist. And, you know, and more pressure's being brought on authorities like us to be able to, you know, meet these demands. So I don't think, you know, that any of the rhetoric that comes out about the 2% precept, it's a load of nonsense. It is not in any way meeting the demands that pressures, even in a borough like ours, even a small borough like ours, that we're having to face. And, you know, going forward, taking away our rate support grant, the only sources of income this council are going to have are business rates and our council tax and any income we can generate, you know, from elsewhere by becoming more commercial, which is why we're developing our large transformation programme. But going forward, if you look at our council tax base, most of it's in the low ABC bands. You know, we're not in the high earning bands. We don't get enough from that either to be able to support it. So, you know, things are looking dismal for authorities like us, certainly on adult social care, the pressures here. And I think, you know, it needs to be flagged up, it needs to be said, and, you know, there needs to be some pressure put on the government. I know through the LGA they are trying to bring pressure to bear, but it seems to be falling on deaf ears, I'm afraid. They're just not interested. But it's a disgraceful situation, it really is.
People don't seem to realise that this government announced a living wage and what the precept is doing is it's underpinning the living wage. So effectively, our precept is paying people for that extra wage within the homes and the care that they work for. And Anne is quite right. There is no account taken down in the Shires where everybody lives in band F or H of your council tax that comes in is much, much higher than it is here. The deprivation that we have means that older people need more care anyway. The demographics of the rural means that we have a really, really, really aging population. And some of us, I think, are going to be there soon as well. But none of this is taken into account by this government. This government seems to have turned their back on places like us, and it's an absolute disgrace, and more needs to be done to highlight it. I think the autumn statement just shows exactly what this government is up to and where their interests are, and it certainly isn't in the board of this country, that's for sure.
Okay, any other comments? Okay, so we've got the recommendations on page 30, and then the additional one that I've moved on the social care issue. So can we agree those recommendations? Okay. Thank you very much. So that takes us then on to item 8, which is the capital monitoring report for quarter 2. Again, I don't particularly want to highlight anything in particular in terms of the recommendations, but I think there are some really good projects in here that we're investing on in our capital programme, which are kind of referred to in the report. So I don't know whether any cabinet members want to pick that up. Tony?
Thanks, Chair. Certainly for families and well-being, we've got into the capital programme a new classroom that's been constructed at Ellery Park, which is really going to be one of our special schools in that. And it also includes external accessibility and play areas, which is very important in children with special educational needs. And the other special school that I'd highlight is Sandling School, the new school that was built a couple of years ago. And now we've put into additional classrooms in that with the very latest and most up-to-date learning facilities and IT and all that. And also the proper sort of assisted lifting and all that. So that's excellent news. In our one of our mainstream primary schools, Merrisey Park, additional classrooms are also provided there. And I think something else that's very important is the we're almost at the completion of the Hive. I know it's gone on for years, and people thought it would never happen, but the completion date is now going to be February 2017, which is good news for all our young people of the world and for families as well. And then in addition to that, there's been a number of say the officers have done an absolutely fantastic job here, and you know, I'd just like to give my thanks on behalf of the cabinet to the officers who put in all that. So good news there, Chair.
Okay, thanks, Sammy. Any other Stuart?
Thanks, Council. I'm just on the highways on page 46, 3.35. The investment we made in that highway, didn't we?
Okay, so some positive projects there in terms of how we've invested the capital programme. So thanks to all involved in that. So can I ask you to turn to the recommendations on page 43? Can we agree that?
Yes.
Thank you. Takes us on to item 9, Treasury Management Monitoring, mid-year 2016-17. I just wanted to flag up here the excellent work that our Treasury Management team has done, particularly in identifying 8.7 million WAF savings for this financial year, which are very much needed in terms of the pressures on our budget. And I think the imaginative way they've come up with these savings is really good news. I keep asking Tom, can you do a lot more of this? Because I think we will need it. But no, seriously, I think it's really helpful, and it does kind of take the pressure off the overall budget if we can realise savings of this magnitude in year. So that's really all I wanted to highlight in this report, and ask you to look at the recommendations on page 16. And ask you to agree those recommendations. They agree to
agree.
Okay, thank you very much. Moving on to I think the one of the key reports on this agenda, which is the medium term financial strategy and council tax budget for 2017-18. I'll just say a few words to introduce this, and I'm sure I know colleagues will add to what I'm going to say. We're not setting the budget tonight. I think that's important to make that point. What we are doing is presenting the kind of financial strategy that will underpin the detailed budget proposals that we clearly will consider at the end of next February, and then formally at Budget Council in March of next year. But I think, Ann, you kind of highlighted some of the issues here. I mean, we are clearly, there's no question in my mind, facing the biggest challenge that we've had financially. So £132 million of savings to be delivered by 2020-21, £45 million next year. I think £45 million is the biggest quantum of cuts that we've ever had to find in 1 year. So we have a huge challenge. And that's largely because of a couple of things that Anne, you alluded to. The fact that, first of all, the government is completely phasing out the revenue support grant, which historically has funded many of our public services going forward. And also the changes to business rates, I don't think they're going to help us, sadly. And also, as you say, Anne, the government effectively are leaving us in a position where the only money that we'll be able to bring in will be from council tax receipts, business rates and fees and charges. Now, that's fine if you are in an authority like Westminster with, you know, multi-million pound properties and corporate blue chip company headquarters that bring in, you know, literally millions and millions and probably billions in business rates. But our challenge or our issue, we've got a local tax base. With George, what we were saying, you know, 3/4 of the housing stock in bands A, B and C. So we will not raise anywhere near as much from the increase in council tax and the social care preset than much more affluent authorities in the south of England, which again I think just emphasises the unfairness of the system that we've now got. And you know, I think we do need to continue lobbying the government to review that system, because I think it is fundamentally unfair to the poorest authorities, particularly in the north of England and in areas like Merseyside. So we do face a huge challenge, and what this report sets out is our plan for dealing with that, which effectively has got three main strands. One is to bring in more income resources over the next 4 years. And I think it is important to say this is a four-year strategy. So we do need to realise more council tax receipts. We do need to realise more business rates by building more houses, creating more businesses. And that's why projects, frankly, like the Hoylake Golf Resort is so important.
Yes.
Because if we don't bring in those additional revenue streams, I ask the question, where will the money come from to sustain and continue to fund our public services beyond 2020-21? So those people who say we shouldn't do any of that, I think, need to answer that question. The second strand in this is the agenda around what we call in this report delivering differently. So this is the transformation programme. So we are literally reviewing every service that we provide and looking at new delivery models like community interest companies, social enterprises, mutuals, etc., that have the ability to lever in income streams that we simply can't as a local authority. So we will be coming forward in the new year with some proposals around these services, but I think this is going to mean a huge kind of cultural change to the way we do business as a local authority and to the way our staff operate. We will need to be a lot more commercial and we will need to really think kind of outside the box in how we deliver services going forward. So details still to be finalised, but I think this report is just highlighting that this will be a huge priority for the administration going forward. And then thirdly, we will have to, or we will be looking at a whole range of efficiencies around reviewing our contracts, reducing our bureaucracy, streamlining our layers of management, etc. And we need to, we've done some of that in the last few years, but we need to do a lot more of that going forward. So these three strands of work will, I believe, enable us to balance our budget over the next 3 years, over the next 4 years. And then we will, in addition to that, because you know, I think we as a responsible administration, need to do this, we will look at clearly at all our reserves and balances. And obviously, there is a review going on, and we will release as much of that as we can prove we do. To make sure that we balance our budget. 2021, we may only literally be able to deliver our statutory responsibilities, and even then, I know some authorities are saying that they may not even be able to do that. So I think it is incredibly important that we, you know, we focus on the three areas I've mentioned if we are going to deliver a balanced budget. And I think finally, before I bring other colleagues in, we do need to keep the pressure on the government. They cannot, I think, as you say, Dan, just basically pretend that there were no problems with the local government funding. And I really do think we need to politically keep on lobbying ministers and particularly the Secretary of State for communities and local government to review the way the funding formulas work, because it is fundamentally unfair to authorities like Wirral. And unfortunately, at the end of the day, the people who are suffering are our residents and our most vulnerable residents. So that's really all I wanted to say in terms of introducing the report, but colleagues may have other contributions. Matthew?
Thank you, Phil. Support what you've said so far. I think there's a few comments that are worth making here. I think clearly we identified on page 88, it shows that 10% of a 10% reduction in senior management is actually delivering about £500,000 worth of savings. And I think that's a bit of a demonstration perhaps of the government here, that we recognise that perhaps those sometimes with broader shoulders can bear that. And whereas with the Tory agenda here, the pain is raining down the very poorest in our borough, and I find that reprehensible right across the country. This is what we're seeing that the Tories are doing. They don't seem to have an appreciation for the fact that on Wirral, we have a much higher, to reference tonight, a much higher number of properties in the lowest council tax bands. We have a duty to support and protect those people, but they have a duty to fund it as well.
Okay, Janette?
It's just a follow on from what you have just said. I mean, when Theresa May was crowned, I'm sorry, when she became Prime Minister, she sort of made a bit of a big deal about abandoning George Osborne's crazy austerity economics. And I'm just wondering whether that's lip service, really, because austerity is biting hard on Wirral, and the continued bringing down on local authorities such as ours does not say to me that they are abandoning austerity economics. They seem to be pursuing them with a vigour. And we need to, you know, we have to note as well that we're better off the local authorities have given a nice little handout last year, earlier this year, to help them, you know, to help ease the pain of the constant they've given, which were marginal compared to ours. Of course, they were all talking councils. We didn't see anything this place was robbing. They didn't have enough time. But I'd like to see Theresa May put her money where her mouth is, if she truly is abandoning austerity, and translate that down to rural council.
Okay.
I just think what's happened on the back there, this is a system that is fundamentally
gap for 17-18, as I mentioned, is 45 million, and the funding gap for the whole period, 17-21, is 132 million. I'm sure it's 132 million, it says in the report. Item two is the impact of the budget reductions and proposals for 2017-18, 2020-21, as summarised in section 3B noted. And then officers be authorised to complete any required consultation and engagement with residents, partners, other stakeholders where required on budget proposals in advance, as I mentioned at the start, of the budget decisions in February of next year. And can I just say, just on the back of what Joyce said, you know, I think we have got a very good partnership with our trade union colleagues. I think we will give this undertaking, continue to consult with our trade unions and make sure that hopefully we can work in partnership to try and mitigate the worst impacts of these budget savings. So I'll give that, reiterate that commitment this evening. Item four, the report. This report being presented to our overview and scrutiny committee workshops, which we've scheduled for January of next year. So that gives a wider group of members an opportunity to consider these proposals in advance of us coming back with the final budget proposals in February of next year. And then finally, recommendation five, an updated budget report and medium-term financial strategy be presented to Cabinet on the 20th of February, and that will include updated financial projections, including the local government finance settlement, which is expected any day now, I think, Tom, and the outcome from the engagement and consultation process which we will carry out between now and that point. So those are the recommendations in this report. A big challenge ahead of us, but I think we are determined we will meet that challenge. So can I move forward with those recommendations? Is that agreed?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, item 11 is the council tax base for 2017-18. These are the clauses we need to agree under the financial kind of rules and regulations. I don't propose to highlight anything in detail. You can see the recommendations in front of you. But I know, Janette, you want to just mention one thing in particular.
I do. One of the most distressing consequences of austerity has been the increase in domestic abuse, and it's undoubtedly Wirral unfortunately has a disproportionately high rate of that. So I'm really, really pleased that we actually, in my tweets, and I are putting on the email about this, we're on the email pledge for zero tolerance to domestic abuse, and we're helping to support our refugees. So just want to make that point.
No, that's it's a really important point, and I'm so proud that this Labour administration is continuing with that that policy to provide those discounts to those two services that do fantastic work in the borough. So absolutely echo those sentiments, Janette. Right, so we've got the recommendations in front of us on page 93 and 94. Can we agree them?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Okay, that takes us on to item 12, which is the Budget Council agenda and procedure for our Budget Council meeting on the 6th of March, I think. So do you just want to highlight one item?
Yes, Chair, just as an amendment to the procedure, which I've referred to at page 112, and you see a table of speakers, the third box makes reference to the Green Party member, that needs to be removed, because that's the Green Party member allocation of time is addressed in box 4. So would you reckon, ask for that amendment to be made, and a revised procedure would be circulated with the council papers tomorrow.
Okay, can we agree that?
Yes.
Can we agree to that amendment? Okay, thank you very much. Surges. Excuse me. Okay, on to item 13, which is the Wirral Plan Progress Update 2016-17 Quarter 2. Anne, do you want to introduce this, please?
Thank you, Chair. This report provides Cabinet with a progress update on the ongoing delivery of the Wirral Plan and the transfer pledges, and it focuses particularly on activities and successes in Quarter 2, that's July to September. Just a bit of background, Chair, this report is a summary update on progress in delivering the Wirral Plan. The performance of the Wirral Plan is monitored by the Council's own review and scrutiny committees and the Wirral Partnership Delivery Group. But I'd just like to draw attention, Chair, if I may, to a number of highlights within the report. Certainly on the going through them in order on the business side of things, I'd like to draw attention to the fact that the overall employment rate in Wirral has increased by 2.3% since the last comparable period over a year ago, and also to draw attention to the innovative Wirral Ways to Work programme, which has seen more than 200 residents supported in seeking employment and training opportunities throughout the summer. I know this has already been mentioned in previous report, Chair, but and Stuart drew attention to it, but the improving conditions of Wirral's A, B and C roads have returned to an excellent position, with targets for 16-17 being exceeded, and that's good news across the borough. On the people area, a pilot approach to identify socially isolated older people has been completed in Eastham and Oakwood Church. Certainly I was involved myself in the Eastern one, and 76 people were referred to services and agencies across across the borough in terms of social isolation. We're just waiting for an update on the feedback from the Woodchurch event. But this certainly is showing that, you know, where there is social isolation, where we can reach out with our partner agencies, where we can contact people who need help, we are able to identify them. Also, on the take-up of the two-year-old offer in terms of childcare has improved from 72.2% a quarter one to 74.1%. We know there is still, this continues to be a challenge, and there is still work to be done there, and there is an action plan in place to take forward further work there. Also, to be mentioned about the refuge, there does still remain an issue across the borough in terms of under-reporting and domestic. But also we have a Rural Peer mentor project developed with Tomorrow's Women, and that is, you know, hopefully going to be a project that is going to bring forward a higher percentage of reporting across the piece, and we've got high hopes that that is going to be a successful project too. On the environment, a couple of issues. We had a really successful Festival of Transport in Birkenhead Park a couple of months ago. We've had the Wirral World Classic, which was attended by people from all over the world, which was hosted by the Royal Liverpool Golf Club. And these events, of course, have contributed to the wider economy of Wirral in terms of bringing in revenue, receipts, businesses, restaurants, all, you know, a lot of our businesses have benefited from that. And just one final one for me to mention, Chair, which I think is worth drawing attention to, is that we continue to have strong performance across the enforcement of littering and fouling. I want to get this right this time. Over 5,700 fixed penalty notices have been issued for littering offences, with over 1,900 prosecutions being referred to the court, and out of those, 1,396 were successful in bringing about a conviction. The dog fouling performance has also increased month on month as well. Yeah, so it's showing. Yeah. So I'll let you say the numbers there. But what we're demonstrating here is that progress towards achieving our pledges, progress in the world plans. I mean, I know Cabinet is going to have a session on looking at all of the pledges shortly to review exactly where we're up to and where we may need to put more action in. But generally, what I want to say, Chair, is in terms of this report, it's forward and, you know, good progress that we're making on our pledges.
Thanks.
And the report is noted, Chair. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Any comments, Ms. Janette?
Just a brief one. Thanks to you, Ms. Grace, for being here for making it. On regarding our pledge for the old residents we've had in our house, we've got a project called Take Away from Change, which is proving to be really popular in primary schools, but also amongst local businesses who we link with. So
so that's really good, you know, to
step forward. Am I right in saying that the project has got kind of national, has received national
awards?
Yeah,
it has. It won the Takeaway for Change on a national award last year, as being one of the best ideas that have come forward, and it has made a massive change in Rotten Ferry and in other areas down here in Wallasey. The children and their families, are coming in and doing cooking lessons as well within the school to be shown how to make healthy meals, and it's real, it's making a real difference. And it's been run through the trained standards, actually started it off, and they've started with the other one, haven't they, where they reduce the strength. So we started off over there, and now they've done it through a partnership now with Public Health, but we started the training standards to initial idea, but it's won a national award. It's a fabulous project. Only one with a couple of officers. It's amazing how hard they've worked and the initiative they've shown to push it forward.
Well, I think we should formally record our thanks to those officers who've been involved in that project, because it's a fantastic project. Okay, great. Okay, we're going to go back, so we'll note that report. Right, on to item 14, disposal of Eighth Lane Professional Excellence Centre in Bromwell. George.
Thanks, Sean. Purpose of the report is to advise members in terms of disposal of the site of the former Eighth Lane Professional Excellence Centre in Easton. As part of the Council's 5-year plan, proposal will be brought to support the following pledges. Which is council making better use of its assets and to build 3,500 new homes. The sale of this asset does affect the Eastern Ward, and the report is a key decision due to the financial implications. And from that point of view, Phil, I would recommend that we accept the recommendations that the terms of the sale are set out in the report be noted. Cabinet authorises officers to accept a guaranteed minimum figure or any other higher figure achieved through negotiation with the developer to reach the final figure depending on the affordable homes outcome. And three, that it is noted that as part of the Wirral plan, the proposal in this report supports the pledges to ensure the council makes better use of its assets and meets the council's targets of 3,500. So,
is that agreed?
Agreed.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, so item 15. Bernie and Stuart, you need to leave.